Hare Krishna to all the participants. Welcome to the ISKCON's weekly program. So today is an interesting topic, Form and Ordinary Language by Dr. Jyoti Ranjan. So Dr. Jyoti Ranjan is a PhD in Particle Physics from Harish Chandra Research Institute, a premier research institute for mathematics and mathematical science. He has published many papers in international journals in the area of supersymmetry, phenomenology, quantum vacuum stability, universal extra dimension, etc. He is also an institute silver medalist from IIT Roorkee in integrated MSc physics. He is a recipient of Infosys Fellowship, Inspire Fellowship, Dad Fellowship, etc. He has authored a book titled Faith and Reason on Trial. So let us welcome Dr. Jyoti Ranjan and for the today's interesting lecture on form and ordinary language. So Dr. Jyoti Ranjan, the floor is with you now. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Praveen Kumar, Prem Kishabu. So, although this lecture was initially scheduled a series on Bhagavad Gita, but due to festivities and all, so we rescheduled that series to start from 4th April. So instead, we'll be having two lectures on this topic, form and ordinary language. So I'll be taking a mostly philosophical route, and occasionally we'll talk about some science wherever it is relevant, and also we'll touch upon connection with other religious philosophy also, in particular Vedic philosophy. So that would be a discussion for the next lecture, next session. So today I'll be mostly focusing on philosophy. So particularly Western philosophy and how it started, maybe to start from Socrates and Plato, Aristotle. So then we'll see how science developed and how this concept of form means something, some universal concept. Just like suppose an engineer makes a bridge, so he makes a blueprint before that. I hope my voice is audible perfectly. So if not, then just
yes, listen, yes, no? It is quite clear.
Okay, thank you. So so just like a engineer, when he builds a bridge, so civil engineer, so before that he makes a blueprint. So that means the blueprint that he learned from his education, so that blueprint is really the blueprint for kind of similar or such bridges. So all the bridges that we really see are the instances of that universal concept, and that is historically called as form, and it has parallels with our understanding of form also. So just like you are looking at the screen, maybe your smartphone, maybe your tablet, maybe your laptop or desktop, whatever device that you are using that you are participating in this Zoom meeting. So you see the form of the object before you. So it has certain dimensions. It is occupying certain space around you, and in time also it is. At some point you positioned that machine. At certain point you initiated the meeting, and all these things have a. Those who are in the familiar in the language of mathematics or geometry, these have coordinates in space or time. So the conception of form that we carry is kind of a difference of spatio-temporal positionings. So that is basically the form that we ascribe. So just like this laptop or this your mobile, your smartphone, whatever. So you fix a coordinate system, you start from x equal to 0, t equal to 0, and then you measure the difference at some certain point. So that comprises the form. And then, so what is the connection with ordinary language? So in its first glance, it may appear that this is a very strange topic to discuss. Form is something different, say, conception in geometry or mathematics or physics, that kind of science. And then ordinary language is a topic of language is a top, I mean, it's a humanities department subject. So what is the connection? So you would see, if you analyze carefully, so then we'll see that, so whatever that we experience in this world, so ultimately we express that through our language. So here the word ordinary, I'll discuss what it really means to qualify it as ordinary. So the reality that we think of in this world and the language that we express through our conscious perception, so they're all intermingled, they're connected. So you see the three objects, the concept or the form or the instances of that, then there is the observer who experiences that, and then when it expresses the connection, when he his experience when he expresses, so that comes out as ordinary language or language. So in our local colloquial terms, just the ordinary language, just like we use English, Hindi, Bengali, whatever your preferred way of communication. So there is nothing to do with a particular language structure. So the experience, like you are watching this Zoom screen and somebody having the similar setup, he's also watching the same thing. And we all describe that I'm watching this sentence itself, that I'm watching the screen, or I'm listening to such and such person. So that requires a language to communicate. And you may also think of expressing the same thing in terms of in some computer language as well. So just like if you see how this Zoom software is working, so you'll dig into the code base and you'll see how the audio codecs are processing the audio, how the video codecs are processing, and then that is different levels of programming languages used to transmit the message. And then at your end, you receive and your machines decode that, and you hear the physical picture or sound and whatever. Okay, so that's a brief understanding of form and ordinary language. Having said this, so let us proceed formally. So I'll talk about what is form. I just now described a little bit. We'll talk about Plato's cave. So its significance in today's discussion, perceiving external world, what it means, the language as a mirror of reality. So and idealizing an ordinary language, how it can help us and why it is necessary, and what are the pitfalls also. So these are some of the out points that I think of covering. And the next session, we'll be talking more in terms of Vedic paradigm. And so that is for reserved for the next time. So today we'll be talking mostly in terms of science and Western philosophy. Okay. So let me ask a question. So to all of you. So all of you can feel free to put your response on the chat box. So what makes a wise man wise? So it may be a very naive question, but I certainly need inputs from all of you. So what makes a wise man wise? Yes, please. I hope people are listening. So, wisdom. Yeah, true. Anything else? Thinking before speaking. Yes. What else? Speaking or doing right thing at the right time. Yes, great. Vishnu is saying experience. Yes. Soumya is saying knowledge and realization. Sitender Kashyap is saying that learning from experience. Yes. So all these things comprise of what characterizes a good. Ankur is saying good decision in difficult circumstances. Yes. So these are all part of wisdom. So and the more to that is experiencing. I mean, wisdom that is in the domain of religion. or metaphysics. So Mrs. Bela Malik is saying his or her thought process according to situation. Yes. So these are all guided by wisdom. So why is the word comes from wisdom? I mean, it's related word is wisdom. So let us take that wisdom. So all the things that you all said. So the concept of wisdom. So wisdom is a let me call it a universal set or universal principle, universal thing, concept. So that is wisdom. And those who possess and those who instantiate this wisdom, so they are called wise men. So this concept of wisdom can be seen all these, let's just example, the photo is there. So all these wise men, they are discussing over some philosophical thing. So discussing. So that, so they all carry a certain level of wisdom. So the universal concept of wisdom and the instances of that are these wise people. Okay, so then what makes an apple an apple? So, or what makes an apple red? So I would again ask answers from all of you just to make you awake. So what makes an apple an apple? So it may be a very strange question. What makes an apple? Or what makes you as the you? Or what makes this laptop as the laptop? So Sam Sundar is saying that color and form, okay, perception. Yes, these are all broad things. It's DNA. You can talk in terms of all these things. That's why this is called language game. So there was a philosopher, Ludwig Wittgenstein. So he says that these are all language game. So form and taste, pigmentation, yes. So so let me call it appleness. So those objects, this abstract concept of appleness, one who possesses one material object that possesses this concept of appleness, that is called apple. Or a chair, a physical object that possesses a quality of a chair. So that is chair. So these words may be appearing very strange. So these were there in there in the discussion of early Greek philosophers, and of course those knowledge was transmitted from Vedic paradigm, the Vedic Naya. So there this kind of understanding is there that so you identify an object through the help of a universal set. So the like this apple is identified as appleness, and when it comes to objectively describe, so this appleness is abstract concept. So like all the examples that you said, DNA and the texture, the color and everything, so they are actually it leveled down. So when you want to express in terms of objective language, so then you choose this terminology. DNA is before DNA is coined, nobody knows what is DNA. So or what is color, nobody knows before it is formulated what is color. So these are some language structures that we carry with us to express the reality. If reality, for example, this the apple that I am talking about, this apple is certainly, and most of us will agree that this apple is not an illusion. I mean, it's really physically there. And so suppose you have a basket of apple, you can really touch it, you can really feel it, you can taste it. So that experience, and then the word experience again comes. But that is secondary to the quality of appleness. And similarly, what makes the apple red? So redness. So these are, so the point that I want to emphasize is that anything that we talk about, so when it comes through our mouth or any terms of communication that we know, maybe a programming language, maybe our mathematical equations, or maybe some biological models, or maybe some physical models, whatever we do in this world, anything that we conceive. So that conception came into existence as an instance of some abstract existence. So that is called the universal or the concept, or that is what is called form in the language of Plato. Hope this point is clear. So similarly, what makes this beautiful valley beautiful? So that is beauty. And this concept of beauty or concept of appleness or concept of whatever the universal set that we are talking about, so they are really very abstract, and they really do not exist in this world. I mean, if at all it exists, we really do not have access to those form of reality. And this is the discussion of ontology. And those who are not familiar can just Google sometime in Wikipedia or whatever, you can start, look at what is ontology. Ontology means you talk about the object in its own identity. So that is, so what Plato said, so the reality that we are seeing before us, the reality that is behind this transient world, like you may be sitting in your room, your fan is moving, your AC is working. So you see the state of the machine is changing continuously. And even the state that you are in, I mean, our own body, that is also keep on changing. Like it said that in 7 years, the whole cells of the body are replaced. So anything that we perceive in this world, they are on change. So that's why time is for us, time is moving forward. So we really do not go back. So I mean, till now, I don't think any solid scientific theory is there. I mean, of course, our physical laws are most of the times time reversible. But in actuality, we don't have any instance where time gets reversed. So always the things keep changing. We really do not get back to the earlier state. And that's why the entropy also increases of this world. So the concept of all these universal concepts, so they are what is called form. And Plato believed that this transient world perceived through what? Perceived through our imperfect senses. And that is not really the final world. And somebody may be happy with this transient world, ever-changing world, but people practically, personally also have seen people who really think very deep. So they are not really satisfied with the transient world or the transient happiness also that we derive from this world. Maybe you may love to eat an apple, but as soon as you eat, start eating the apple is finished. And for example, many of you may be in some college or in some university. So as soon as you enter, you know that there would be one day that I would come out. The reality that we perceive through our imperfect senses, so they are not really the final word that is there in this world. And so Plato believed that maybe there is another world, and there the concept, the abstract ideas of form, the universal ideas that I was talking about, the appleness or beauty or ideal friendship or whatever we know in this world, it has its ideal counterpart somewhere. Because why he believed like that? Because this instances are changing, and I have multiple copies of instances. Just like I have a dog, and there may be many more dogs of the same breed. And that concept of dog, that universal idea of dog, so that exists in some transcendent world. And we call that world of the forms, and that is never changing and eternal. And certainly it is not really part of this physical world, at least not accessible directly through this imperfect senses. So maybe some of your mic is, let me mute. Causing noise. So forms are not part of this physical world and unchanging and eternal. And how do I really get to know what is the form? It's okay that you may say any kind of jugglery. And how do I really verify what is my access to the forms? So that actually made Aristotle very troubled. So although Plato was more like a Vedic philosopher, but Aristotle, his student. You see this picture, Plato is raising his index finger up, but Aristotle is showing his hand, right hand horizontal. So what it signifies is that Plato said, so in the universal concept, the form, the universal reality, that is the blueprint of this whole creation. And that is there in the transcendent world. But Aristotle said, no, it's not that. Aristotle said, so he differed from his master, and he said that actually, the universal concept of form that you're talking about, that exists in this world. And here started the whole era of, I would say, natural science. That how science started evolving. So that, this is the point actually where Aristotle, so he differed from his master and he thought that the forms that are of this world, so that is not really, I mean, that's not part of this world. So they are in the, they are part of this world and they are very much accessible through our body. And just like we as transient entities, our body is changing ever. So Plato thought there is a soul inside us that is not changing. But Aristotle thought that no, actually the form is this body only and it's not changing. Soul is really part of the body. And so that that idea kept continuing. And when Christian era started and Jesus Christ preached all over the Western world, I mean, the area where he preached, and then the message got communicated to all over. So then the idea of Aristotle was later and was very popular. It received a lot of attention, particularly in the medieval time, in the 14th, 15th century, 16th century. So that marked the beginning of scientific and industrial revolution. So there people really rejected any kind of transcendent reality, and the natural science got separated from philosophy, metaphysics. And science as a separate discipline, as objectively studying this, that became prominent. As science progressed further, objectively understanding this, that moment. So that is some discussion about form and the difference between the ideas that promoted by Aristotle and Plato. Okay, I think let us move a little fast, so a lot more to say. So forms appear to be abstract universal concepts. So just like we may talk about friendship, but in this world some friend of us may betray us, relations break. What Plato thought, he thought that the ideal friendship, ideal relations, everything ideal. So all kind of idealized versions, they exist in the transcendent world, Platonic world, what is called in philosophy. So just like the dog I was telling, so all those dogs that we see around us, so they are all the shadows of the universal ideal form, the dog. So this physical world is really particular instance of the blueprint. Just like in the initial, I was giving the example of breeze and the engineer. So the engineer takes a blueprint and he makes many copies of that blueprint all around, and we see that breeze around us. And just like I was there in sometime in Allahabad, and there was a breeze, long breeze, Shastri breeze. So there, and similar, there would be many such breezes nearby places. Just next to that, there is another breeze. Next to that, there is another breeze. So there are many breezes. And they're all shadows of one universal concept, universal idea. Okay. So, but then the question is, okay, it's fine that the forms do exist, but I don't have really direct access to them. So, because they are beyond my space and time, my whole scientific formulation, whole ideas, physics, chemistry, math, geometry, whatever I know, so they operate on this physical space and time. But then how do I perceive? But I have only interaction with the shadows of these forms. That's why there are many theories, many forms, many models, and so many ideas that is evolving in this world. But what Plato believed, that he thought that this world of forms can be ascertained through reasoning and logic. So here actually the difference between, fundamental difference between, I would say, the Greek philosophers and Vedic philosophers. So there, the Vedic philosophers say it's okay to resort to reasoning and logic when senses are imperfect and our senses cannot decipher the nature of reality. And there is yet another level of proof or the epistemology. So that is they call Sabda Praman, that I will not talk about. So the point is, Plato believed that everything, in fact, the whole of Western philosophy thinks this only, that everything can be ascertained through reasoning and logic. And even if transcendent world is there, that is kind of irrelevant. Just like those who attended the last discussion by Professor Gupta, on Big Bang cosmology and religious implication. So the idea of logical positivist kind of empiricists who think that whatever you see in this world, so they are all everything that you can understand. They are the only reality. And even if, there is not really any metaphysical world or transcendent world, they are irrelevant. I mean, they don't exist, because anything that you cannot experiment and observe, that doesn't exist. So it's not really a statement of science, actually, I would say. So science never, science is open-minded study. I mean, in its precursor, natural philosophy. It's true that natural philosophy restricts itself, but it really doesn't say that it cannot, the access to the transcendental world or the forms of Platonic world, they are not accessible. Maybe we do not know the current state of development of logic and reasoning that we are limited to. So that is, it doesn't have access. Maybe there are higher ways to access to those stratum. So, okay, that is all. So having said this, Plato gave a very wonderful analogy. So the role of philosophy in our life. So you see this figure, it's called Plato's cave. So there are set of prisoners who are tightly held to the wall. And the only thing they can see is the picture on the wall of the cave. And behind them, there are people who are carrying the objects and the shadow that is getting reflected on the cave, cave wall. People who do not have access to the, because they are so tightly held to the wall, they don't have access to anything else behind them. So they are not really seeing all these models or these objects, the cartoons that you are seeing, the horse or the jug or the birds or the ring, whatever. So they only see the shadow. So they may be formulating, theorizing based on the shadows, and they may come out very successful in modeling all these shadows, because this shadow are the replica of the, they kind of have kind of correspondence one-to-one, not really one-to-one. So the dimensionality has already reduced. It's in a different dimension. So, but nevertheless, it has correspondence with the original objects they are behind them. But these original objects, they are a replica of some original entities, the horses, the jugs, and all the birds, they exist in the real world. And those fortunate people who have escaped this cave, and they come out to the sun and they see the whole world around them, and they come across the this object, the horses, the birds, the jug, the ring, everything in their reality, so they know what it is. So it's a very wonderful example, wonderful analogy that is given by Plato. So it actually summarizes the Vedic paradigm that we'll be discussing the next time. It's a fascinating discussion of Achintya Veda with philosophy. So, and its connection with the nature of reality that we have, and the nature of form in particular. So, those fortunate people, they have access to the original, the truth, the forms. So it's just an analogy, not to stretch too much. Having said this, Plato's idea, so let us now analyze what is an external object. Just like the screen before you, the laptop screen or the mobile screen or whatever you have, the wall, the room, your own body itself. So you are perceiving your own body, the objects around you. So how do we really perceive this world? So it's a question that has bothered people from the very beginning of intellectual history. So all those philosophers and everybody is really puzzled that what is there in this world? What is the reality that is that characterizes the object that I'm seeing? Just like this person is looking at the candle. The candle is external. So external means that something that exists outside me. But what is outside me? mind, if I analyze, my brain is also outside me. If you carefully see, so what is me? I'm not this hand, I'm not this leg, I'm not this head, I'm not this nose, I'm not this mouth. So what I am? So if you analyze carefully, the whole body itself is an external identity. So that led to believe many philosophers, just like Plato, that there is an eternal form that we call soul in Vedic paradigm, and they also call Atma, and in their language they call soul. Of course, soul has multiple connotations in Christian religious understanding. What we really perceive in this world is everything external to us only. So what is internal? It's a debatable question, and that is the whole discussion in the cognitive science and study of consciousness, the nature of perception. So the everything that we so just like I am sitting before the screen. So this screen is related to me. The identity of the screen and everything, the existence is in relation to me. So the existence of the external object, and it has a connection with the observer. So it cannot be separated. So nowadays people talk about quantum epistemology. So I mean, quantum mechanics, those of who are from physics background, they know that quantum mechanics is plagued with this measurement problem, and more fundamentally, as some great thinkers say, it's a problem of observation basically. So anyway, we'll not talk about that now. So now the question is our perception a reality or hallucination? How do we really differentiate? A person, suppose you suddenly in the middle of night, you woke up from your bed and you are in a half sleep mode, and there is somebody before you, you may not be seeing him properly. So all you see is kind of, you are in a hallucinated world, you are in the half in your mental world, half in your real world, and the reality that our mind cooks up, it's a different thing that when we are awake, we see, just like the Plato's cave example. So the reality that somebody is beyond that paradigm, and the reality that somebody is a hallucination or case tightly held together. So it's different. So although the form, the universal set, that is intact, but the understanding, the modeling, and the realization, the expression through language, that is different. So how do I really say that what is real and what is not hallucination? And it may be appearing a very naive question, but actually if you go very deep in the study of philosophy, so these are very fundamental questions. And that is how we have many different theories, even many different religions, that how do I justify, I mean, what is reality and what is not reality? What is hallucination? And how, religion, we talk about religious experiences, revelations. So how do I really justify what is really a revelation? If at all there is any grain of truth in that, and if it is not, so how do we really justify? So that first person experience of reality and the third person objective description of reality is always very relative. The experience of time, the experience of space before us, they're all relative perceptions. Like Einstein, he gave very wonderfully, gave the theory of relativity. And earlier people used to think that everything is absolute, just like the ideas that Aristotle propagated, that this the forms exist in this world, and to save that the origin of the universe, he said that this world is eternal, this physical world is eternal, there is no creation and there is no dissolution. So the important thing that is contributed by Einstein is that in fact there is a creation, and in fact the perception of world before us, that is a relative understanding. And if you go one step further, and the perception of even those, whatever the ideas that we have, so they are also in another sense a relative understanding. They exist on a relative platform. So just like somebody's brain is not working, just like somebody suffering from schizophrenia, a mental disorder. So for him, the reality is a different story altogether. Or suppose we are not really in happy mood, somebody said some bad words to us, and So then the understanding that we carried at that moment of the world, it's very different. And suppose somebody is very absorbed in his study, like many of you maybe may find great absorption in your scientific and philosophical research or whatever. Somebody watching a movie, time runs very fast. So this is not really the relativity that Einstein talks about. This relativity is at the very fundamental level. I mean, the perception, the relative nature of perception is a great area. And of course, those of you may be interested, they can communicate to us. So we are very much interested to study these things, the relative nature of perception. So making a very solid scientific contribution to that. So those who are interested, they can surely contact us. So the relative nature of perception, how they really differentiate that it is reality or hallucination. There is no way that I can do. I mean, I may talk about logic and reasoning, but how do I really justify that right at the very first place, what I am observing, that is the real thing. Just like those of you have watched the movie Matrix. So you may be saying that, okay, it's fine that everybody else, in fact, it is the reality, so why to bother much about that? But then the question is raised to one more level, that how do I really differentiate that I'm not living in a world of Matrix, the idea that is given in that movie. So, so if you look carefully, what is reality? How do I really, how it is become realizable? So just like this neural structure you have in our brain, so these neuron structures, whenever we see any object before us, so our eyes or our ears, our nose, our tongue, our skin, they experience this knowledge, these five knowledge acquiring senses that is talked in Sankhya, of Vedic Sankhya. These sensory models, they carry those information, and then ultimately it reaches brain, and then it's processed through. We really do not understand how we become conscious. And suddenly, if I naively say, suddenly all of a sudden, all this information, magically it gives rise to consciousness, magically gives rise to perception. Relative nature of the world automatically comes out. So it's a very fuzzy thing, and we really do not understand these things properly. And science is moving forward, and the more we are moving forward, the more we are limitedness of our reasoning and logic. And it really calls for revision of our logic and reasoning, that like our ordinary language, everything, all logic and reasoning that we know is expressed through our ordinary language. So ordinary language is not something. What is that? Just a minute. Yeah. Okay. So ordinary language is that that makes us that gives us models, that gives us expression of reality and communication between us. Even communication that we carry in our mental process also, that is also kind of in some. There are parts of speech and all this. So this is also kind of a reduced version of ordinary language. You may be that logic and reasoning are very wonderful things, the mathematics. But in fact, actually, our ordinary speech, our ordinary expressions are fundamentally more powerful. Hello, is my voice audible now?
Now okay, but in between some problem is there.
Okay, so just the last
now it is okay. Now okay, continue. Yes, please.
Okay. So there is a reality, and there is a perceiver and the experience of that, and that is expressed through language. And which of these how do I really justify which of these items really exist in reality? The ontological structures of these ideas, the experience, like when I see the screen, or you are hearing me, or the reality itself, the universal object, or the perceiver, myself. So what is the ontological state of these things? I really do not know. I never understand these things, actually, because all my expression of language, all expression of programming, all expression of modeling, all mathematics, all logic that I know, they are result of my experience. So they are at one stage lower. And I was talking about ordinary language is more powerful than even mathematics or logic. So because at least the mental processes, the experience of reality that we have, we can express through them. But mathematics, till now, we don't have those understanding. Even in mathematics also, we have problems, just like as described by Gödel, the incompleteness theorem. So that there would be certain propositions that I cannot figure out. I mean, the probability is in question. I cannot say that what is true or whether it is false. So some philosophers, they say that since the language of mathematics has not yet evolved to the stage of our ordinary language, so that's why it is not capable of doing that. So just like numbers, we have a 5 may be a universal concept, but in mathematics, I use it synonymously with 5 as an entity, a collection of 5. So that correspondence, the 5 as an idea and 5 as a count, so they are two different things. So that correspondence is not that is missing. So, many philosophers say that, some say actually, so because of that missing connection, we have the problem in mathematics that is otherwise not there in language. Of course, in language also, there is a problem of self-recursion, and that kind of paradox appears because Gödel's theorem, that is a result of self-referential logic. And in language also, similar things can be constructed. But language it at a higher level. That's why the logical positivist or the ordinary language philosophers, or in particular the Western philosophers, so they say that we need to idealize our ordinary language. And mathematics is one attempt to do that. So they say that if we can idealize, make an ideal version of the ordinary language that we're using, so then we know the reality. So, but nevertheless, there is a proposition and reality, what it really exists in its totality. So that is a question, it's a very fundamental question. It has not only scientific, philosophical implication, it has religious implication as well. And this one fundamental question, what is reality? So that has fueled energy in a transcendentalist, a religionist, a philosopher, a scientist, a mathematician, whoever in search of truth of this world. So he is up to this question, what is real and what is not real? Even in a Vedic philosophy also, there are many branches of philosophy, sub-branches. So based on this idea, what is real and what is not real? Okay, so I talked that language. So why, till now we are talking so much about ordinary language, but what is ordinary language? So ordinary language is not really some ordinary language, quote unquote ordinary, some third class language or not so refined language. So it is really the ordinary use of language. So all the words, all the objects that we see around us, so they are ordinary objects around us. So when we use our linguistics, mathematics, modelings, computer language, whatever, so to express that, that is a language ordinary, that is ordinary language. So so ordinary means ordinary uses. So just like if I say the word empty space or vacuum, so the word may the word has a very different meaning in for a engineer, and the word has a very different meaning for a physicist, particularly those who are in the practice of quantum field theory. So the empty space and the vacuum, so for them it's a totally different meaning. And the same words, empty space and vacuum, they carry a different usage in for a person in the humanities or a person in engineering. So nevertheless, all these are ordinary uses of the word, empty space or vacuum. In the context, so they carry their meaning. So again, the contextuality of ordinary language is also another issue. I'm not really going into the deep philosophical discussions. So in this, those who are interested, they can Google area of ordinary philosophy. Practically, that was a major thrust in 20th century, and for some in 21st century as well. So everything, this contextuality, the meaning, everything comes into picture. So these are such, puzzling areas that we really do not know what is real and what is not real. The ordinary, only asset that we have is the ordinary language, the ordinary usage of our vocabulary. The vocabulary may be the vocabulary of C++, PHP, Perl, Visual Basic, JavaScript, C++, Java, Ruby, whatever, Objective-C, Python, whatever language that you prefer to reality. So like just like those who are in engineering stream or even in physics also, those the reality make a model of that, just like Einstein gave a model of this universe, the laws of general relativity, the rule, the principles. So that was cast into symbols, formulations, if you want to make a practical, tangible calculation, we'll fit into computers and make horrendous calculations, use Mathematica and whatever, any of these tools, and you come out solutions. These are numbers. You see the reality that we started with, this physical world, and the reality that we ended with, the numbers. So they are different, actually. All through, we made one-to-one correspondence between them. But in between, you'll see that we really lose attributes. And the very beginning, right at the level of perception, the understanding, to the point of symbolizing and coming to the point of numbers. So they are very different, actually. So that's why, when we find new observations, we keep on refining our models. That is how science is operating. That the ontological entities of the world, the reality of the world, they're fixed in terms of if you accept Plato's world. And then we make different kind of theorization and modeling of the world, and our theories keep evolving. So then the question is, can we really rid off ultimate ontological structure of reality through idealization of language? So how do I really idealize language? So just like it's okay that if I want to model these dogs, I need to talk about the ideal form of the dog first. Because if I know how to describe this ideal dog's form, how do I really prove that this ideal dog exists? If I can do that, then all these dogs can be instances of that ideal example. Just like blueprint in the initial discussion I was talking about. So that blueprint of a bridge, if I have the blueprint in the mind and or in the paper, whatever, so all the bridges are instances of that. If I can understand the ideal form of dog, so then I know the ideal, the instances, the shadows of the dog, as in Platonic language. So science really talks about technical idealization. In science means, we talk about mathematical way of idealization. The observation that we have in this world, so it needs to be described through the ideal language of mathematics. But how do I really justify that Latin language of mathematics is the sufficient language? I mean, ideally do not know. To assume that the final word would be kind of not really so open-mindedness. And that is what is the basis of scientific materialism or scientism. And religion talks about the elevation of consciousness. It says that it appreciates the importance of logic and reasoning in our world, because it says that we have to deal with this world. So certainly this objective third person description third person usage of ordinary language to describe the forms of this world, that if I want an objective description, so I have the description of mathematics. But religion says that, spirituality says that it's not the end of the story. So it says that we have to reach a level where we may have direct experience of ideal form. But then how do I really know that my experience is not hallucination? So that we'll talk the next class more on that. So then the question is, another question I raise, is a logically perfect language is on this line of thought a literal mirror of metaphysical reality also? So I saw that through scientific modeling that the usage of mathematics, usage of computer language or even ordinary language. So they are trying to make a isomorphic, one-to-one correspondence with the world before us. And is it really true for metaphysical reality? In particular, when you talk about God, soul, all these fancy metaphysical concepts, the universals. So in the Platonic world or in the Vedic paradigm. So can there be a language or can the language that I'm using, the ordinary language, can it be literal mirror of that? So there actually we stumble. So there we discover all kinds of limitations of our formulation. And one class of philosophers, they may be saying that, who is going to bother all these things? This world is all that I know of. And this is all that I'm going to live in. Who has seen this fancy universal and who is bothering about that? This is all one life and let's enjoy. So that's okay. It's up to, it's all individual choice. And but certainly those who are really after more fundamental truth, so they go deeper and ask more fundamental questions like this. So can it be possible to mirror? Or is there different hierarchies of mirrors? Just like if I have the highest level of form, so maybe there are intermediate levels of blueprints. Just like I may have the most ideal thing, little more advanced ideal thing, little more ideal thing, and then the actualization of that ideal thing in the surface, this physical world. So maybe that is also possible. So here is a quote from Internet Encyclopedia of Philosophy, particularly from the works of Wittgenstein, the famous ordinary language philosopher. So he said that reality shares the logical form of language and is pictured in it. It's a profound statement. And this picturing relation between reality and language exists. It cannot itself be represented, nor therefore spoken of in language. See, he is saying, he's appreciating that the universals, the forms, so it can be pictured in ordinary language, but they exist, but it cannot be really represented in or spoken way of communication or theorization, mathematization, whatever. So he says that once you, then why should I do that? So then I would say that if everything is useless, so if my words are also useless, so even in certain Vedic philosophers called Advaitavadis or Mayavadis, they talk about this, that everything is false in this world. Nothing is true. All this transient reality is false. And similar line, Wittgenstein is saying, once its lessons are absorbed, once you extracted everything out of the world before you, and then it is advised that you reject this world. I mean, you reject that understanding. You don't need to bother about the forms that is there in its detail. So you can kick out the ladder, just like if you reach the destination. So so these are some of the understanding that I said. So the question that always remains is, what is real and what is not real? How do I really describe that reality if it is rare? So just like this, the connection between our own perception or understanding of reality and the objects that exist outside us. So in Vedic paradigm, they are called sense objects. Like everything I perceive through my senses, they are sense objects. And Vedic paradigm, Vedic Sankhya talks about another level of reality, another level of blueprint of everything, the space of all other blueprints, the space of forms. That is the mind it talks about. Another stratum of reality between the highest level of blueprint, highest level of universals, and the physical shadows. In between, he talks about subtle matter, that is the mind. And he says, It reminds me a section from a scripture called Srimad Bhagavatam. So they are the 11th book, the 11th canto, 13th chapter and 17th verse. Some of you may Google it and search for it. So what is the relation between my mind and sense objects? So I see that when I analyze, so anything that I see, anything I perceive, they really exist in my mind only. But then the blueprint in the mind that gets instantiated in the physical world as shadows of that blueprint. So where is that object existing? What is the connection between them? That relations, it's not that it is bothering today us, and it's bothering the philosophers today, it's bothering the scientists today, it's bothering the mathematicians or the religionists. It has bothered people for millions of ages. And Srimad Bhagavatam, this wonderful description of this section that some of you may be interested to read, and we'll also talk more in this line in the next class, next discussion. So what is the relation between mind and object, sense objects? So what is the nature of, relative nature of perception? How they're connected? The worlds are before us and the world, mental world, how they're related. And that is what is called the dichotomy, the chasm between mental world and the world before us, the external world. So that what comprises the mind-body problem in philosophy, in Western philosophy. And practically, the whole of Western philosophy could not rise beyond this level, that beyond the level of mind and senses. So just like Plato said, that everything is okay. The universal forms are there, and we need to go to them. I mean, we need to understand them beyond this transient world. But how do I really understand the universal forms? All the method is reasoning and logic. That is where Vedic philosophy and Greek philosophy or Western philosophy or in particular science differs. So that is a discussion for next time. So it would be very interesting. We'll be talking about the relative nature of perception and hierarchies of realities, hierarchies of blueprints, and the understanding of the external objects. And then I'll conclude with a final note that is there in the Srimad Bhagavatam 10th book, 10th canto, 87th verse, sorry, 87th chapter and first verse. So that the dying emperor Parikshit is asking, the great sage Sukadev, that, oh Brahman, how can Vedas directly describe the supreme absolute truth who cannot be described in words? So does that make sense in line of the discussion that we had? That how can ordinary language decipher the nature of reality? So all we have here, ordinary language means, I mean any kind of ordinary expression, the physics, the chemistry, the biology, anything, computer language, languages like Hindi, Arabic, all kinds of English, whatever we know, everything. So if there is a transcendent reality, a God or a transcendent absolute truth, how can words describe them? So you see, ultimately the scriptures that we have, so they are the words only. So we process through our mind. We express through our own language, maybe English, maybe Sanskrit, maybe Urdu, Farsi, whatever. So maybe we have different circumstances that have given rise to different religions, different scriptures, but there is a universal that they're all they're trying to describe. And isn't that? So here is an open-minded inquiry by the emperor, dying emperor, that he's asking that, how do I know that the words that you are talking about, that you are saying, the words of the scriptures, they are not really deceiving, and they describe the absolute truth perfectly. How do I know? The Vedas are limited to describing the qualities of material nature, but the Supreme is devoid of these qualities, the universal, the ideals. They are beyond the shadows of this world and being transcendental to all material manifestations and their causes. So he's talking that, how do I really formulate? How do I conceive those inconceivables? So the question comes, is it possible to conceive the inconceivable? So, I have conceivables and inconceivables, they can exist together. So that is what is called Achintya Bheda with philosophy in our, in particular in Gaudiya Vaishnava tradition, right? I will be talking about next time. And how ordinary words can perfectly or may not describe that. So that's a topic for next time. Thank you for your kind attention. And any of you might have felt it's all boring or kind of jugglery of words. So now maybe you can ask.
So I think.
And if you have any question, you can.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Jyotiranjan. So it was a very thought provoking. And philosophical lecture, wonderful lecture, wonderful presentations. So I think participants can directly ask questions instead of writing in the chat window, because there are less number of. And
they can unmute themselves.
Yeah, they can unmute themselves, and then Vishnu, you can you can unmute yourself.
Okay, so my question is, what factors do on what factors does this perception depend upon? It depends upon, it differs from one person to another person. So what are the external or internal factors that may be different, so that the perception of every person is relative to other?
So if I understand your question properly, so you are asking what are the factors we all have different experiences. Is that so?
Yes. So from your perspective, what are all the major factors that will affect the perception of each person?
Yeah, so actually all of us are individuals, and all of us occupy different, if I talk in terms of language of physics or mathematics, we all occupy a different spatio-temporal position in this world. And all of us are different entities, like you are certainly a different entity from me, because we differ from spatio-temporal positionings. And certainly you look like me as a human being, so there is a universal idea, universal conception that unifies you and me. But there is a difference that differentiates you and me. And so like you have your own mind, you have your own neurons, own functioning of brain, and I have my own. So even though both object before us, but the processing, that is very individual. The reality is perceived as a first person. Initially it's the first person, then expressed as third person through objective uses of language, whatever means. So since we both of us differ in terms of situations, and so we have different perceptions, even though we are looking at the same object. So you may be having a different understanding, and I may have different understanding. Actually, I have a slide for that. So I think not this one, the duck or rabbit example. So you look at this object, duck and rabbit, the same figure is giving the understanding of duck if you look along x-axis. If you look along y-axis, for you, it would appear like rabbit. The same object, somebody looking at y-axis, it would be a rabbit, and somebody who is looking at the x-axis, so for him, it's a duck. But the rabbit and duck, they exist simultaneously as universal concept. So in this figure. But for you, it may be different. For me, it's maybe different. So that's the nature of actualization of the original blueprint when it expressed to the shadow copies. But the ultimate reality, so that is the universal form. So that's a different thing. And to access that objectively, and of course, it's not really true that everybody would have the same experience of the reality. And that's a discussion for next time. And we'll talk about the nature of rasa that is there in the religious experience. Just like somebody who is friend to me, like I have a friend in this meeting, or somebody who is your father, somebody who is your mother, So all these kinds of relations, we exchange some kind of rasa with each other, the loving affections, the loving mellows, whatever you say. So that exists, and the variegatedness of the experience with the ultimate blueprint, ultimate reality, it has to be there. I mean, the Vedic paradigm says that, in particular, the Gaudiya Vaishnava tradition, it says that you cannot really separate out the variegatedness of experience in relation with the original blueprint, and it has to be there. Yet some other philosophers, the Advaitavadis, they say that actually those different classes of relations, the experiences of reality should not exist, and ultimately the reality is only one and just one, nothing else. So so that is a fascinating discussion, or more of a religious, in the language of religion, the experience of religion. So we'll touch upon that next time. I hope this answers your question.
Wonderful. So before moving to the next question, I would request the participants, those who have joined first time, so please drop your mobile number in the chat window so that we can communicate to you about forthcoming seminars or conferences in the month of May and also in the April. Okay, so now coming to the next question. Yeah. So the question is asked by Satendra Kashyap.
Yeah.
So he's asking, is there just one ideal dog in the universal set of form? Or we have one ideal dog for every breed, say German Shepherd, Bulldog, Labrador, etc.
So I partly answered this question. So it differs actually. You see, ultimately, it's the perception of reality. Until and unless we have direct audience with the reality, it's not possible to say. But then we talk about the ideas we have in our religious scriptures. So the Achintya Bhedavad philosophy that Gaudiya Vaishnava tradition follows. So there is not really one and only blueprint. So there is always variegatedness. Even the original universal form, that also exists as different individual universal forms. Like the dog. There may be different copies of German Shepherd, Bulldog, and all kinds of varieties of breeds of dog in our society, in this world. In the world of transcendence, or spiritual world, as we call in religion, so in Vaishnava tradition, so there are all kinds of varieties. In fact, Bhagavad Gita, those of you have studied the 15th chapter, it says that this world is a reflection of the original world. So that's the variety that is there in the universal world that exists in this world as a kind of shadow copies. So you may not really map as one-to-one, just like in your home, there may be a pet dog. You may not really map onto, maybe there is another pet dog in the universal paradigm, I mean the abstract paradigm of spiritual world. So that correspondence may not be true, because the dog may be existing as a shadow copy of something else. so it's a different understanding. So not really to be stretched to that extent.
So basically, Dr. Jyotiranjan, you meant to say that somebody who has access to the ideal, the world of ideal forms.
Yes.
Who has access, he can tell.
Yes, that is.
He
that
can
is,
only tell that what is there.
That is what is called in the language of a great philosopher called Jiva Goswami. So he calls it Vaidusa Praman, Vaidusa Pratyaksha, right. I mean, or Dibya Pratyaksha. Transcendental Pratyaksha means the sense perception. When your senses, just like this, Parikshit is asking in the 87th chapter, prayers offered by personified Vedas. So how the language of the scripture, they really capture the reality, because reality is in transcendence, if at all it is there that you are talking. Then how ordinary language of this world captured that reality? So the point is, the sages who have access to the transcendent world through the realization or experience of the truth in its totality. So they only have ways, so they can describe in terms of the words. That's why the Vedic knowledge is not really literary study. So even if you study whole of Vedic literature, remember everything, every bit of it, still it doesn't mean that you understand any bit of it. It's it actually starts from there. So just like the philosopher's cave I was talking about. So unless and until somebody really comes to the level outside, I mean, he doesn't have direct experience of reality. Till that point, this knowledge may be a yardstick to go. And it may help us. This may be a symbolic language as well. That's why we have different religions. They differ on this ground. When they use that universal idea and they talk in terms of socio-temporal or whatever circumstantial changes around them. So depending on that, they use different languages to describe that universal truth. So that's why every one of us differ. Even in one practice of religion, many people differ. So that is what I want to mean. Okay, so.
Okay, so any other question anybody would like to ask? So Indrajit Prabhu, can you please show the announcement?
Okay, brother.
Yeah, yeah. So in the meantime, participants can think about their questions because... Okay. So we have two wonderful programs coming in the coming weeks. So... Can you make it bigger, Prabhuji?
Yes, Prabhuji.
So this is an example of self-referential logic.
Yes.
Twitter boots into it, the program boots into itself. So it keeps on moving in a... It's a limitation of programming language. That so...
Okay, so this scientific and practical principle from Bhagavad Gita. So this seven session, it's quite an intellectually stimulating and spiritually nourishing series, starting from wellness, societal application, and the second conference is coming is this is 3S conference. Sustainability, Spirituality, and Simplicity, 22nd and 23rd May. It will talk about environmental ecotheology, environmental sustainability through spirituality, through simplicity, environmental sustainability through social and cultural heritage. So all world-renowned speakers are available from Utah State University and Australia and the actual people who have worked like Goranga, Das, director Govardhan Eco Village, and many more, because we could not capture everything on the poster. So there are not many people who would be joining. So please register for this conference. The link is available. And and this is on 22nd and 23rd. That's all. So something. So so there you can unmute yourself and ask the question.
Yeah, the question is about an example that you give of that was gave. So it was practice, right?
Sorry, because of internet connections, I'm not able to hear properly. Let me switch to a different network.
Yeah.
If you can type it or just let me switch to...
Yeah, it. I have typed it.
Okay. So the question that you are talking about the ideal dog and universal setup form, is that so? That I
No, not that.
Another.
My this connection disconnected, okay. So I didn't receive the chat. So could you please?
Okay, let me. I'll paste it again.
Please.
I think now you are able to hear, so I can read it for you. Okay. So how do we know the Plato's cave is not embedded in another Plato cave?
Yes, that is true. That is how we have different hierarchies of blueprint.
Yeah, and the a minute. The question is not ended. So how do we know the Plato's cave is not embedded in another Plato's cave, and when does it end? What is the last Plato cave? That is when will we know we are in the outermost Plato's cave?
Yes, that is a very interesting question. Thank you, Sitender. So the point is, so just like one day, perhaps it was Hawking or who, that an old lady was arguing with him that you don't know that how this universe is there. So this is all stacked upon one tortoise after one another. So then where is the end of the tortoise? So kind of it's a question that is keep coming in different forms in different disciplines. So just like if seed is the original blueprint of the tree, then what gave rise to the seed? So it's a it actually really falls into, if you approach in terms of ordinary logic, ordinary language, or whatever tools we know of, so it really falls into the paradigm of self-referential logic. So we really, through mind and senses, particularly logic only, we cannot figure it out ever. But that's why the Western philosophy could never find a concrete answer to this kind of questions. And so, if you look at our Vedic tradition, so there we talk about this Divya Pratyaksha or Vaidusha Pratyaksha. So that means the person, the practitioner, so he transcends this world so much that he is not really dependent on his own mind and senses to process the external world. That means he is observing the reality in its ontological state. I mean, its own existence, own reality. So that means a direct audience with the reality. So at that level, I would ask, how do I really say that it is true or false? So suppose I claim that I have religious experience, I have realization, and I have experience of God or experience of these metaphysical entities. So then how do I justify? So if I have any doubt in my mind, and if I have any confusion, that means I am not at that level. And so any sensible person who is not really dogmatic and not really blinded or biased by kind of doctrines, he would always not cheat. I mean, somebody, it's really the experience of reality is mostly a first person reality, and or it may be a reality in an objective sense, but for those who are on the same level. So all of us, those sages who talk about experiencing the reality in its total full.
Your voice is gone.
If somebody says that he is experiencing the reality in its complete form, so if I have any confusion in his mind, whether it expresses or not expresses, so that means he hasn't captured the full reality. So the praman, sabda praman, the basis of sabda praman is this vaidusha pratyaksha or divya pratyaksha, transcendental sense perception. So there is no tinge of confusion. And that observation is itself the proof. It is a self evidential. There is no need of any other proof to substantiate it. And those people on that level, they have the same experience. But people like us, who are stacked in multiple caves, if you like to say, multiple levels of blueprints, multiple levels of reality. In particular, we have a transcendent world, we have this physical world. Inside the physical world, we have this mental world and the gross world. And in the mental world also, there are hierarchies. The level of mind, the level of intelligence, level of identity, false identity, and even in the gross world also there are different levels. So all these different hierarchies, they give rise to different blueprints, different universals. And you can, if you like, you can think of as caves stacked in one side, other. But what is the final one? So that is, somebody who has experience only, he can say, me or whoever doesn't have experience, we can take help of the realizations of those people and may approach. And if that is the truth, that is the final word, then we'll also realize. So, but there is nothing harm in progressing open-mindedly. So that is all I can say. Is my voice
okay? That's
okay.
Yes. Now your voice is clear. So it is already going to be 7:00. So can we wind up with Phil? We can take the last question if anyone want to or comment. Vignesh, Shyam Sundari, Bela Malik. So okay, we'll share the recording. Yes, all of the recordings are available on the YouTube. If you go to the Institute for Science and Spirituality channel, so all of the recordings are available. So it takes 1 or 2 days to edit the recording and then upload. So probably today's recording will be available 2-3 days after, but previous one recordings are already there. Okay. Okay, so we can stop now. And
okay, so we end the meeting over here.
Okay, thank you. Yeah. Thank you, Jyotiranjan, Dr. Jyotiranjan. Wonderful insight, wonderful philosophical deliberations, wonderful seminar. Yeah. Okay.